Hello and thanks for joining me today. In this video, I want to talk a little bit about the connection between hearing and function of the palate muscles. So something I've come across both personally and with physical therapy patients is some people come in with a complaint of ear fullness, subjective complaint of hearing loss, and they often say, I went to the audiologist. And I had the same experience, went to the audiologist, had a test done. They said my hearing is fine. Went to a neurologist and they said, maybe you have vertigo or an inner ear problem. And then I went to physical therapy for this prior and it never got any better. And I can't hear. And I know I can't hear, but everyone's telling me basically I'm crazy. And it's unfortunate that that's the case, because while there are dysfunctions of the nerve that can cause a true hearing loss in a conventional sense, there are other things that can change the way that your tympanic membrane and eardrum pick up vibration. And there's a Eustachian tube, which is in the middle ear, that responds to changes in ear pressure, which can also affect your hearing. So in regards to the palate function, there are two palate muscles. They're called the tensor and the levator veli palatini muscles, and they're muscles in the back of your palate that actually attach into that Eustachian tube. So a deficit in hearing due to a dysfunction of the Eustachian tube because of a dysfunction in these muscles is not going to be necessarily picked up on a test you would have done by the audiologist. And it would be also true to say that in that case, there would probably be no dysfunction of any of the auditory nerves. And so in order to restore this hearing, which I've done successfully for myself and for patients, there's a couple of things that you have to realize first. So first of all, these palate muscles are functioning in relationship to the physical arrangement of your upper jaw, your maxilla, your lower jaw, your mandible, and the activity of chains of muscles. Okay, and these chains of muscles are not just only specific to inside the mouth, but they're also connected into your neck and kind of upper rib cage area, and then even lower. You know, all these different chains of muscles, and we learn this in PRI, come in and can affect each other, right? We live in a human body that's a closed system, so everything is working together at all times. That's why someone with this hearing loss, they might work their left adductor and inhibit one of these lower chains of muscles, and they might actually feel that their hearing improves in their ear. Go tell that to a neurologist, as I did, and you'll be looked at as though you're crazy. Okay, and you're not crazy, but what's happening is you're using one muscle chain to inhibit another, which is actually affecting the relative amount of activity in a certain muscle, which happens to go to your Eustachian tube, which is affecting the ear pressure, which is affecting the way that you're picking up sounds from your environment. So you're not crazy, you're just in a situation that is not yet well described in the literature, and it's not yet recognized by really any healthcare professionals. So when you're dealing with these issues, first you have to kind of look at, okay, what are the large magnitude players that could be affecting this from a, you know, the bottom up, right? And then also, what are the structural level abnormalities or problems that might make this situation so it can't be fully mitigated, right? Someone that's not hearing well because they have a serious dysfunction of these muscles is going to make some improvement just by working these muscles and addressing chains that are lower. But if there's that significant structural abnormality between the upper jaw and the lower jaw, there's going to be a reason why those muscles either can't turn on or turn off or work in a balanced fashion like we want them to. And you're not going to be fully able to ameliorate someone's symptoms in that case. Okay, so you're going to make progress, but you're probably not going to get all the way there. Now, in another case where there's not a structural dysfunction here, and it's more just functional from the way that these muscle chains are interacting, then you have a good chance of getting there, you know, or almost all the way there. So once you've taught someone how to hold their diaphragm and the rib cage in the right position. Then you can go after the neck and posture and also function of these various neck muscles, which we've talked about somewhat in other videos. Some of the main muscles you're really going to want in are those levator scapulas to pull that neck back. You're going to want to shut off the front of your neck through some inhibition techniques, and PRI works great for that. Now, once that stage is set from below and you've turned off some of the bigger muscles that are in a chain that these palate muscles are in, then you can go after those palate muscles and be a little bit more sure that you're going to get some result without other bigger things getting in the way. Okay, so that's the sequence that I like to go at it in when I'm thinking about it, when I have a patient with those like, you know, subjective complaints of fullness in the ear, hearing loss, and I also see signs of things that are happening in the palate where there's a dysfunctional inability to use the palate and the tongue. So then after that, you kind of have to look at, okay, can this person stick their tongue out, and are there asymmetries in the direction, whether that's up down or side to side, because that's something you're going to have to take care of. A tension in a tongue and a lot of tension back here in the muscles that attach to the tongue and the lower jaw, okay, that can affect the way that a palate can raise up, and also someone's swallowing pattern and their ability to create an intraoral vacuum during swallowing can also affect the ability of that palate to raise up with the tongue right before a swallow is completed. So John and Mike Mew with Orthotropics, they talk about this micro swallow technique, which I find is very effective once you've cleared out the neck and any tongue restriction, soft tissue tongue restriction. So I would say you do some neck techniques, you get your levators going, you shut off the front of your neck, you make sure you have adequate flexibility with tongue protrusion, you can stick straight out, also up towards the nose. You can put the tongue in front of the teeth and open, keeping the tongue up in front of the teeth. You can stick out and open wide. You can protrude your lower jaw and the tongue and open. So those are some of the tongue jaw flexibility type things to free up this area. And once you've done that, then you can go to this micro swallow. And so how it goes is you form saliva in the front of your mouth with your lips sealed. As you collect that saliva in the front of your mouth, you gently start to roll it up into the middle part of your tongue that's between your hard palate and the middle of your tongue. And you just collect that by sweeping back. They call this a tongue sweep. And then once you have a good amount, like a good bolus of saliva in the middle of that tongue between that and the hard palate, you seal your lips. And you initiate a swallow where you're trying to pull all that saliva back into the back of your tongue. And when you swallow, you're going to notice the back of that tongue at right before you complete the swallow. That's going to come up right on the back of the palate where the hard and soft palate connect. And that's going to come up there. And if the back of that tongue goes all the way up into the soft palate, the chances are that soft palate's going to come up with it. Right, you're going to feel this feeling of a vacuum inside your mouth. Once you have that, keep your lips sealed and repeat, continuing to swallow. And you're going to raise that whole soft palate up. Okay, at that point, you should hear a little bit better. You should feel a difference. Maybe you'll feel like the pressure in your ear has changed, or there is some air coming in and out of your ear. And you know, if that's not the case, then you might have to spend a little more time on tongue flexibility, making sure there's symmetry in both directions, making sure you have range of motion coming out. And then in other cases, the tongue is so overactive because of a malpositioning between these jaws that increasing the activity of the tongue actually messes with the palate and makes one side even more overactive, which then shuts off the other side. And in that case, you're in a scenario where you really just need to go see, you know, the appropriate orthodontist, dentist, maybe oral surgeon, maxillofacial surgeon, because at that point, the overactivity of muscle chains is more related to a structural issue. And you can do some tongue retraining, but you just have to realize that you might have this variable function in that hearing. So you have some improvement and then it will go back, or you have some improvement and then you'll hit a plateau, which you'll oscillate between slightly better than that level and slightly worse than that level once you hit that point. So that's the connection. To recap, sometimes we can't hear because there's pressure changes in the ear and decreased function of the Eustachian tube relative to these tensor and levator veli palatini muscles, which are in the back of the palate. This can be linked to overactivity of chains of muscles that are connected into your neck and jaw, which can be related to malpositioning of the jaw, underdevelopment of one or both jaws, and also malocclusion, which is not good contact between the teeth, which is usually due to underdevelopment of the jaws. And in addition to thinking about getting the neck and jaw working properly and working on the swallowing, also clearing out lower chains of muscles that might be related to diaphragmatic breathing, core musculature, even pelvis dysfunction is an important part to make sure that the things of larger magnitude that may be sending dysfunction up the chain are also addressed, in addition to these kind of more local chains and the two little muscles there in the palate that will actually directly help that part of the ear. So thanks a lot for watching today's video. That's about it. In short, make sure your head's in the right position, take care of your breathing, and get that micro swallow where you're creating an intraoral vacuum, tongue is on the roof of the mouth, and then continue to swallow with the lips sealed, getting that soft palate to raise up, 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 and up into that soft, into that hard palate with the tongue in a swallow. So that's it. Not the most organized video today, but that's the deal. See ya.